tonight?
Well, rather than this being a matter confined to one reporter and one private investigator and a one-off, it's quite clear that the use of hacking into mobile phones was on a mass scale. This was a newsroom completely out of control, with scores of journalists involved in it, involving thousands of people, with potential criminality on a mass scale too, which is why the newsroom was out of control. It's an enormous story, and much of my mind, one of the biggest stories of journalistic practice and ethics of modern times.
Is this in any sense normal practice?
I think it's fairly widespread in Fleet Street, or what we used to call Fleet Street, yes. The Information Commissioner produced a list of newspapers that had been involved in getting information to private detectives who are known to use these illegal means of obtaining information. And in that list, he listed the number of instances that concerned each newspaper, and the News of the World wasn't even at the top of it.
So you wouldn't even be surprised by this?
Not really.
Andrew Neil, you've worked for the Murdoch Empire, 11 years. Is there a hands-off approach? Is there a sense that you can do whatever it takes?
Well, in the world of red-top journalism, of this particular tabloid journalism, it's fiercely competitive, and the pressure on you to get stories is huge. The more salacious, the better. The more sex involved, the better as well. The more secret, the better too. So you are in a climate where almost anything goes. Whatever it takes to get the story. Look the other way if illegality is involved. As long as you've got that splash on Sunday, you've beaten the opposition. If you've got to use private detectives, if you've got to intrude in people's privacy, if you've got to break the Data Protection Act, do it.
We've had very little from News International tonight. Just that one line, it feels it's inappropriate to comment at this time. How do you think they will respond to this?
They must be terrified. If this was the United States, they would now face what you would call a class action lawsuit from hundreds of people who've had their mobile phones hacked into and other elements of their privacy abused, and they would be facing a multi-million pound lawsuit. So far, they've paid Danegeld. They've paid a couple of people to keep quiet, for the documents to be sealed, and for nothing more to come of it. John Prescott's already rampaging around. There could be plenty more. And this isn't just the News of the World that's in the dock, or, as Peter rightly says, other newspapers too. This is our criminal justice system that's in the dock. This is the police who are in the dock. Why did they not inform the Deputy Prime Minister of this country that his mobile phone had been compromised? Why did the Crown Prosecution Service not proceed with prosecutions? Why did the courts allow this crucial information to be into a sealed file that you and I are not allowed to see?
So where does this investigation, if you like, go from here? You would want to know, presumably, as John Prescott said tonight, why the Met Police didn't alert anyone.
I would certainly want to know that. I mean, that whole sequence of events seems to me to be absolutely extraordinary. And I think another thing that this shows is how weak the system of press, so-called system of press regulation is. The Press Complaints Commission was supposed to have looked into this whole matter following the jailing of the News of the World reporter and the private detective who had supplied him with illegally obtained information. And the Press Complaints Commission didn't even interview Andy Coulson, who was the editor at the time, because he'd resigned and therefore he no longer came under their regulation.
Yeah, Andy Coulson, a very clear statement from him, who says, "I took full responsibility at the time for what happened on my watch, but without my knowledge and resigned." And he says, "This story relates to an alleged payment I made after I left the News of the World 2.5 years ago. I have no knowledge whatsoever of any settlement with Gordon Taylor, one of those allegedly paid out. These are allegations, of course." We heard the commentator in this piece saying questions about an ivory tower editor. Does such a thing exist?
Well, I hope not. I think that if you're an editor and one of your journalists comes to you with a story which clearly involves very sensitive and private information, then the first question you will ask is, where did he get it from?
Quite apart
from anything else, you want to know that your story is legally sound and copper bottom.
The first question any editor asks if somebody comes to you with a scoop is, how did you get it? Because the provenance of the story is vital to any legal action that may follow, and also vital for you to make a judgment, is this story accurate or not? Yes. Every editor has to ask this question, but we now know from the Guardian story, which seems to me to be pretty accurate, that this wasn't just a one-off story coming. This was systemic in the newsroom. This was being used by scores of journalists. So how could an editor not know that was the modus operandi of his journalists in the newsroom? To me, it beggars belief.
These are allegations, of course. What do we know about, or what do we understand about the role of the judiciary in this? Is there a turning of a blind eye ever in terms of the sort of privacy laws?
The judiciary, to me, seems to me that it has been complicit with News International in making sure that all the facts don't get out. The relevant facts that this was a much more widespread, that many journalists were involved in it, that phone records were being transcribed and handed around the newsroom, which had all been denied, not just denied to other journalists, but denied to Parliament, to the select committee that investigated it, all turns out not to be true. And yet the evidence that shows it's not true is sitting tonight somewhere in the Inns of Courts or in the Justice Courts, and we as citizens are not allowed access to it.
Gentlemen, thank you both very much indeed.